Well, hello everybody. This is Pastor Jackson here again with a word from the G Block, and we're here to this evening share with you Bible study. That's right, Bible study. And those of you who have been tracking along with us know that we've been talking to you about the sovereignty of God. That's right, the sovereignty of God. That's been our study, and I want to pick that up. We're still on the sovereignty of God. This is an amazing study. So I want to invite your attention to the book of Philippians, chapter 2, and verses 12 and 13. That's Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 and verse number 13. That's going to be the basis of our study. Today, I want to talk about the sovereignty of God in our salvation. That's right, the sovereignty of God in our salvation. Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 and 13. So then, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed me, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence. Here's what I want to get to. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Verse 13, for it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Work out your salvation with fear and with trembling. So what we want to deal with, sometimes there has been some debate between God and human responsibility. That's right. There's a debate between God and human responsibility as it relates to our salvation. And so we've got to look for and see if we can find where that balance is. What is our responsibility while God is at work? So we have to go back in this text back to verse 27 in chapter 1, where and Paul is talking to the church at Philippi. You're aware, he says, only conduct yourself in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or remain absent, I will hear of you that you are standing firm in one spirit with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. And so you see, and I won't get into where the Greek is in that, but what we do know, according to verse 15 of chapter 2, that God is at work. That's what we'll see. So that's what we want to deal with. So there are four areas basically I want to look at as it relates to the sovereignty of God. And remember, those of you who have been tracking along with us know when we deal with the sovereignty of God, that is, God is in charge of everything. And we're going to see, even according to Philippians chapter 2, how God is in charge of our salvation, and that God is at work even in our salvation. So what we want to, first of all, four areas that I want to touch on very quickly. The first is, I want to talk to you, is we must possess salvation before we can work it out. Hear that again. We must possess salvation before we can work it out. Remember, Paul says to the church at Philippia, at Philippi, work out your salvation. So this salvation is a theological word that sometimes is tossed around and without us really paying any attention to the implications of the word. We just toss it around, throw it around like it really means nothing. So salvation is like a person being in a situation where they are mortally wounded. What they need is a doctor, or else they will will die. And so what we see is the condition of every man without Jesus. A man who's outside of Christ is in a situation where without Christ's intervention, he will die. So when it comes to salvation, we know that we need someone to intervene. So what we will see is the Bible is clear that we can never work out our salvation to earn it or to merit it, since it was a free gift. Ephesians 2:8-9, we've talked about that. For by grace are you saved, and that not of yourselves. Remember, it is the gift of God, lest any man should boast. A lot of people, they always connect God working in their life with their good. That's flawed theology. Let me say that again. They connect how God will work and how God will respond in their lives is predicated on them. Well, that's kind of flawed theology. It is the gift of God. You're not going to heaven because you're a pretty good person. You're not going to heaven because you are a nice person. You go to heaven because God has granted to you the gift of salvation. So, but remember, it's God. God is at work. God is at work. So, and because God is at work, we got to learn, once we possess salvation, then it is necessary to work it out in this practical and everyday implication. So they had obeyed the gospel, whether he was present or absent. And so he was sure they were not just obeying him, but they were obeying God. So if this church at Philippi, if their obedience was just to please Paul, then they were not pleasing God. So we need to learn how to do whatever we do to please God, not to buy things from him or to think that we would dare to get anything from God. So we must possess salvation before we can work out our salvation. Here's the second thing. Now, salvation from start to finish is God's work. From start to finish, it is God's work. So the reason the Philippians needed to work out their salvation was that it was God who was at work among them, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. So here's how the Bible puts it together. Let me refer to my notes here. We're not saved because we choose God. We're saved because God willed to save us. So he began, watch this now, and pay close attention to this. I want to show you something right here. He began a good work in us. As many as received him, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God. So God exercises his will in our lives and brings us forth by the word of truth so that we might be the first fruit among his creatures. So listen, Jesus said in John 15:16, we did not choose him, but he chose us. Y'all, that's something. We didn't choose him. Before we knew who we were, God had already chose us. So Jesus said in John 6:44, no one can come to the Father, he says it, unless the Father draws him. You see, God is always the one at work. It's God who does the drawing. I hate to say to us, we're just totally wrong when we say we found the Lord. The Lord was never lost. The truth of the matter is, God allowed you to see him for who he really is. Not who he was, but who he really is. So you didn't find God. God always had his eyes on you, and God willed it. He willed it so. So salvation depends on God choosing us and irresistibly drawing us by his grace according to his good pleasure. He drew me by his grace. Nothing E.O. Jackson did, nothing E.O. Jackson could have done, but he chose me. So God not only wills our salvation, here's what you need to know. He works it. Look at it now. You look back over your life, you will see how God worked that thing. He works our salvation. So salvation is not by any human effort, but it comes from the power of God. So there's nothing we can do. There's nothing we can do that will negate God's salvation in our life. So number three, watch this. Although salvation is God's work, it requires diligent effort on our part. It's God who's at work, but he does require some diligent effort on our part. Now, this kind of sounds a little bit like double talk, but stay with me and watch this, because this is good theology, and you need to know this. So there's an illustration, Matthew 12, when Jesus goes into the synagogue, and Jesus says to this man, stretch forth your hand. Watch this carefully again. Jesus says to the man, stretch forth your hand. Jesus told the man to do it, and the man obeyed him, and his hand was fully restored. On another occasion, in John 5, Jesus told a man to get up and walk. The man didn't have the ability to walk, but Jesus told him, you get up and walk. And guess what? The man did it. In both cases, these men did something that they thought that they could not do. They could have said, and if they had said, I can't do it, guess what? They would not have been healed. God worked, and this sounds a little bit, but it's deep. God worked, but they had to work also. So hear me, so there will be no misunderstanding here. There's a sense in which receiving God's salvation requires diligent effort on our part. But if you sit back and say, well, I'm not sure whether I'm one of God's elect and there isn't much I can do about it, then you'll be lost. That's complacency. And complacency is deadly. You have got to put forth and have a desperate concern about your eternal well-being. That's what 2 Peter 1 and 10 talks about. Be all the more diligent to make certain about his calling and choosing. Jesus talked about that. So he in one occasion, he urged his hearers, strive to enter in by the narrow door. For men, I tell you, will enter in, and I will, and men will seek to enter in, and will not be able. So there are some things we must do. And while I'm working there, I was just thinking, in the Old Testament, there's a beautiful illustration there. There were six cities that were designated as cities of refuge. And regardless of what you had done wrong, if you could just make it to the city of refuge. Listen to me again. Six cities that were designated as a city of refuge. If you could make it to the city, you'd be fine. If you could just make it to the city, one of those cities of refuge. So there had to be urgency to get there. And so it is with Jesus Christ. I don't care what you've done. He is our refuge. Amen. Right there, Bible study. He's our refuge. He alone is our refuge. And if we can just get to him, we'll be fine. If we can just get to him. Remember that now. Even though when we look at this, salvation is God's work, it requires some effort on our part, some diligent effort on our part. Why don't you tell somebody and teach that to somebody? You have got to come to the city of refuge. So the point is clear that Even though God sovereignly wills and works all things to the counsel of his will, at the same time, each one of us is responsible to exert effort to work out the implications of our salvation. Now, here's the last thing that I wanted to tell you. I told you there were four. Here's the last thing, and that is salvation always has practical, relational implications. It always has practical. The main point of Paul's appeal here is this, that if we are truly saved by God's working in us, then we are under obligation to work out our relational differences by following Christ's example of self-denying love. Jesus laid aside his rights, and just as he did not live for himself and his own pleasure, just as he put others ahead of himself, even to the point of death on the cross, we must learn to die daily to self. That's something that we've got to get to the place. Most people, and I hear this all the time when you hear people talk, it's always about them. I am crucified daily, Paul said on one occasion. We've got to die daily to self. Americans, those of us who are blessed to live in this great country, we put too much emphasis on the individual aspect of salvation, not emphasis on the corporate side of it. You see, you got to look at the corporate side of it, and that is that our salvation is intentionally individual, but some people believe that. But you have got to look at the corporate side of this. Now, let me close this. The reason we work out our own salvation in terms of good relationship isn't primarily so we'll be happy, but rather God's good pleasure. That is, to please God, whose pleasure is that his people love one another. I think that's a good place to leave this lesson. Brothers and sisters, we've got to learn that it's not about you. So many Christians, and it's sickening sometimes when you hear people, it's all about them, what's best for me. But remember, God is at work in us. If you can remember, a man was trying to find a juicy bit of gossip and once asked a man if he would see a person who he had disagreed with on so many things. He said, are you going to see him in heaven? And somebody felt that, well, that guy said, well, are you trying to say that my friend has not been converted and I won't see him in heaven? Well, you got to understand that just because we disagree on certain things does not mean that that person won't be in heaven. We can, this little petty stuff we disagree, speaking in tongues and you know, how a person is feel, whether or not it's a second blessing and all of this stuff. But the real question is, how is your relationship at home with other Christians? And if God has saved you, you got to follow the example of the Lord. He laid aside his rights and he went to the cross. So listen, let me wrap this up. And by telling you that the sovereignty of God is at work, he laid out the plan. Remember, I've told you time and time again that we're living in time, what has already happened in eternity. I've already been saved, lived, and died in eternity past. Now I'm just living it out in time. I'm waiting on everything that God has purposed for my life to just happen in time. But one thing I'm excited about, God willed it so he purposed that I would be saved, and I'm glad he did. What about you? Thank you for joining me. This has been Pastor E.O. Jackson with a Bible study from the G Block. I hope that this word speaks to your heart. Out of Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 and 13, we see God's sovereignty in our salvation. He did it, y'all. That's all I wanted to tell you. We'll see you next week, same time, same station, same time, same channel, with a word from the G Block. Until next time, the blessings of the Lord be on you.